Welcome. Thank you for being here. Thank you for being part of our newly formatted approach to functioning as a diversity council and addressing this issue of diversity. We all know that diversity is a core value at UTMB. Many of you were here a few years ago when we went back and thought about our core values. We had a number of them listed. And what we wanted to do was to condense them and focus on the things that best describe who we are and how we work together internally, as well as with all of the external folks who are engaged with us in improving healthcare for the people of Texas. And diversity emerged as one of those core values. Means many things, but we have a marvelous history relative to diversity. A number of firsts relative to education and research and patient care. Things that we can be proud of. Areas in which we've shown significant leadership. And of course, we want that to continue. We also understand that to continue to be leaders in terms of addressing the issues of diversity and inclusion, we have to take some pretty significant steps forward. We clearly have to work together. We all know there are huge challenges in terms of making sure that the healthcare workforce for Texas accurately reflects our population as we go forward, the nature of our population. UTMB does that just as well as anybody, perhaps better, thanks to Dr. Thomas, other leaders in the education system here. But we know that we need to do better. Our state is changing. We also know that our health system is not functioning the way it needs to function. There are a lot of issues with access, poor access, lack of equity of care, lack of effectiveness with different populations, a lot of things we don't understand about what the differences in our patients do in terms of the therapies, our diagnostic efforts that we offer. So a lot of work to do. We also know that diversity offers us great power to make a difference. The more inclusive we are, the more perspectives that we can bring together around a problem, typically the more powerful and more lasting solution that we can offer. So that's what we want to do. Now, this group is a very large group. We know we're taking a risk with 87 members, I think. Is that right, Addie? Okay. But you know what? We've always been willing to take risk to make a difference. So I'm looking forward to working with all of you. Thank you. I know everybody here has a lot on their plate. I appreciate your willingness to add this to your list and hopefully put it near the top, because working together, we can continue to assure that we're going to make a difference, not only now, but for the generations that follow us, in terms of making sure that healthcare is the best that it can be, not only in our state, but around the country. So again, thank you very much.
All right, everyone, how's everyone doing today? You can do better than that. I want to get some energy, and I want to hear the optimism that I sensed as people were entering the room. My name is Adeola Oduwale, and I am the Director for Diversity and Inclusion. This meeting represents the final phase in our process of reconstituting the council. So I want to extend a very warm welcome to all of you who are here today. I want to congratulate you on your appointments, and I look forward to working with you over the years to come, hopefully. I wanted to introduce Dr. Ben Raymer, who I don't believe is here yet. Dr. Raymer has been with the institution for many, many years. He's a very well-known and respected individual, and many of you may already know him. He's graciously agreed to act as co-chair for the Diversity Council. So myself and Dr. Raymer will be working in a mentorship, collaborative, facilitator role with each one of the subcommittees as we move forward. And when he does arrive, I will invite him to make a formal introduction for those of you who don't know him. What I'm going to do is quickly dive into my presentation. I only have 20 minutes, and then I'm going to hand it over to our keynote speaker. And what I want to do with this presentation is share a little bit of information about myself for those of you who don't know me. I have a Bachelor of Science degree in psychology, a Master's degree in Industrial Organizational Psychology. Upon graduating, I went on to work for a small diversity consulting company in the Northeast. That gave me a lot of experience working with a cross-section of different industries around their diversity initiatives. After being in that role as a consultant for about 2 years, I actually moved to Houston, Texas. And what motivated me to move was the opportunity to work for MD Anderson Cancer Center. And I actually worked with our keynote, Dr. Gibbs, who you'll be hearing from later on. Very robust program. I worked in that role for almost 7 years, progressed from an entry-level position to a manager level. And they had a very, very robust program at that time, focusing on many different areas of diversity management. Everything from talent pipeline development to workforce education, specifically leadership development, diversity inclusion metrics, as well as talent pipeline planning. And it gave me a great opportunity to cross-pollinate across all of those different areas. So it was a great, rich experience. I was there for almost 7 years. Then I moved back up north to Maryland, where I landed an opportunity with a smaller healthcare system called Frederick Memorial Hospital, and I acted as their first director of organizational inclusion. I was in that role for about a year and a half before coming back to Texas because the weather was way too cold. And I'm happy to be back home. I've been with UTMB for a year and 3 months now. So here we are, our first meeting, and I'm very, very excited because there's been so much interest in this, and I'm excited to work with all of you in the coming years. So that's a little bit of information about me. I'm a little behind on my slides, but all right. So when we think about diversity, and inclusion. For many people, it's a very nebulous topic. A lot of people don't know exactly what it is. People have many different ideas and opinions. What I want to do is establish a common frame of reference for understanding what that means. So by the end of this 20 minutes, I want all of you to walk away with a common language, if you will, a shared meaning around what diversity and inclusion mean, number one. I also want to talk to you about the process that I'm using to infuse diversity and inclusion into the core areas of the institution's mission work. So I'm going to walk you all through a 5-step model, and as I do that, I'm going to reinforce some of the things that this meeting is all about, which is about intent, impact, as well as imprint. And then very lastly, I'm going to talk about the current Diversity Council, the makeup of the council, how individuals were selected. I'm going to talk about some of the success factors for an effective council, and then we'll talk about next steps as we move forward. Any questions? Okay. All right, so I don't know if you can see this very clearly with the black background, but this is what we call a diversity wheel. And the diversity wheel is a very effective tool for summarizing the many different dimensions of diversity that exist at UTMB. Now, as I mentioned, when people think about diversity, people have many different ideas, many different opinions. But for most people, when they hear the term diversity, what do you think that they think of? Exactly. Thank you, Bree. They think about race, they think about ethnicity, then they think about gender. That's what we call internal dimensions of diversity, and that's what's reflected in that innermost layer of the wheel. That represents a very narrow and a very fixed way of looking at diversity. However, many people, that's what they think of. There was actually a study that was done by the American Society of Training and Development, and they found that 98% of the respondents to that survey thought that diversity meant race. So that just shows you that that's the mindset that many people have around what diversity means. What's really cool about this wheel is that if you look at the second layer, you see what we call external dimensions of diversity. And external dimensions of diversity is the type of diversity that relates to your experiences in life as well as your choices. So if you think about your language preferences, for one, or your educational background, your marital status, your recreational habits, your spiritual or your religious beliefs, all of that falls into that second layer of the wheel, representing dimensions that relate to who you are related to your experiences and your choices. The third layer of the wheel represents organizational dimensions of diversity. Who are you? How do you show up as a citizen of the UTMB community? So everything from being a part-time employee to full-time, whether you've been here for 2 years versus 37, which represents the range of tenure that we have on the council. Are you someone who has benefits? Are you don't have benefits? Where do you park? Where is your office located? All of the things that relate to your employment status at the institution is what we call organizational dimensions. And then the very outermost layer of the wheel represents what we call diversity pertaining to our constituency group. So at UTMB, we serve our patients. We also serve our students. And as you can see in the outermost layer of the wheel are different attributes that pertain to that group. So if you look at our patient population, there's differences in diagnosis, treatment outcomes. There's differences with respect to whether they have insurance or not. All of those variables are things that pertain to the patient population. And then on the student side, you see things that pertain to our students. So the discipline of focus, you know, what school they belong to, et cetera. So key takeaway with the wheel is that diversity extends beyond race and gender, the legally protected groups that we typically think of, and it includes a whole spectrum of human difference. And that is what we're using as our anchoring point around defining what diversity means. Now, if we take it a further step ahead, we look at inclusion. And what do you think inclusion means? I love it. Could you say that louder?
Participation by everybody.
That's a very succinct way of defining what inclusion means. Inclusion is really about how do we recognize that there's more than one view. It's very systemic in nature. It's, again, learning from our differences, making sure that we're creating an environment that supports the engagement, the development, and the contribution of everyone, our students, as well as our employees. I like the analogy of diversity representing all the different ingredients that you see at a marketplace. And inclusion is the process of pulling all those ingredients together and creating a fabulous meal. So kind of use that as an analogy to understand the difference between those two concepts. All right, so this is a framework for understanding the major paradigms, if you will, in a D&I process. The first is really focusing on opening doors, compliance. A lot of the efforts around diversity and inclusion at UTMB was really focused on compliance, affirmative action. So when we think about the numerical representation of different types of individuals in the workplace or in an institution, that's what the first paradigm represents. So it's really about, you know, creating access, creating representation by correcting areas where there's underutilization. The second phase is focusing on opening minds. And that's very educational in focus. So we're extending beyond representation and looking at number counting, but looking at how do we create a workplace climate that is that everyone feels valued and accepted in. So when you think about programmatic activities such as education and training events, celebrating activities like the Hector P. Garcia event, MLK, all of those are programmatic and focused. So it's all about creating education, awareness, and some sort of programmatic activity around diversity and inclusion. But we want to move further to marketplace. And the marketplace system is really strategic diversity, and that's looking at how do we create or integrate or infuse diversity and inclusion into existing processes, existing systems within the institution in a way that benefits our marketplace, you know, our constituency groups, our patients. So I always like to use the example, you know, when I was at the hospital up north, one of the things that they did in order to attract the best and the brightest was they expanded their benefits policy to include members of same-sex partnerships, non-traditional families. And that was a way to target that particular segment of the population from a recruitment standpoint in a way that other hospitals weren't doing. So that's, again, a marketplace focus. It's externally focused, it's looking at the marketplace, it's looking at the changing demographics, and it's developing policies and programs internally that are going to help to bring that in. So HR employer of choice strategies, infusing all of that is really strategic types of diversity. And that's the direction that we're going in at UTMB. Any questions? So workforce, numbers, workplace is really climate issues, education, and the marketplace is really systemic in nature. It's looking at how do we capitalize on diversity as a strategic asset. So I thought that intent to impact to imprint was the perfect theme for today's meeting. And this five-step methodology that I'm going to walk all of you through is going to reinforce some of those concepts. But let me poll the group. When you think about the term intent, what comes to your mind? What does intent mean? Motivation? Okay. Anyone else?
Desire.
Okay. Very good.
Purpose.
That's right on the nail. I looked it up in the dictionary. And that's what intent is. It's a specific purpose. It's a call to action. It's a specific aim or objective. Impact.
Difference.
Oh, yes. Thank you. And who's this? Hi.
Farah Siddiqui.
Oh, it's good to meet
I'm
you.
Here.
Okay.
Good to meet you.
Okay. So
what
you
difference you can make.
Right, exactly.
Difference.
So impact is some sort of differential factor. It's leaving some kind of a mark. And lastly, imprint. Having an effect, yeah, definitely. Having an effect. And so I look at the Diversity Council as that last phase. How do we make an imprint? How do we create some sort of pressure? How do we infuse what it is that we're trying to do into the current systems here at UTMB? So I'll walk you through this model, and I'll highlight all of those things that we just talked about. Intent, impact, some of the milestones that have been accomplished to date through the Legacy Group, the Legacy Diversity Council. And then very lastly, I'll talk about the role that the Diversity Council is going to play in helping to establish that imprint. All right, so the first phase in the model, I'm not used to using this, by the way. But first phase in the model is assessment. When I first started way back in the latter part of May, I spent the first 90 days of my experience meeting with key stakeholders at the institution to gather a lot of data around what the diversity climate was at UTMB. And so what you see here are some of the sample questions that I asked these folks. I took all of that information, all that qualitative information, I summarized it for key themes, and I used it to do three things. The first thing that I did was I used it to inform the next stage, which is the planning stage, when we begin to think about a strategic plan. I also used it to help to think about a quantitative assessment. So we're actually going to be implementing a quantitative survey that will be distributed institution-wide in October. And the survey is actually produced by the AAMC in partnership with the University of Massachusetts, but we customized it with some questions. So that was the second thing that I did. The third thing that I did with the sample questions was really to start to begin to think about what is that plan for action, you know, and what does that look like? And so I looked at strengths, weaknesses, and opportunities and strengths. I organized it into these four categories. One of the things that I thought was a great strength from my observations was the fact that we have a lot of great leadership support. And that, I think, is exemplified by the fact that we have our VP of HR at the table, who's a member. We also have Dr. Callender, who's our leadership sponsor. That's huge. The second piece was the fact that this is a target-rich environment. There's a lot of great opportunities. There's a lot of great things that are already being done at UTMB around diversity and inclusion. And there's presented itself a really good opportunity to pull all of that together and link it to a centralized strategic plan. And the third thing that I thought was a big strength was the fact that UTMB is in a growth mode. We're building new facilities. We're still hiring folks. And research shows that there's a positive correlation between organizational performance and diversity initiatives when an institution is in a growth strategy. Key strengths. Some of the weaknesses were scarce resources, also a history of false starts. Opportunities, great opportunity to create a common frame of reference for understanding diversity. And then, as I mentioned, linking all of these isolated activities to a strategic plan. And then very lastly, some of the threats would be competing priorities, as well as the historic focus from the past on compliance issues and affirmative action, which is part of it, but I think that there's key opportunities to extend beyond that. The next phase was the planning phase. This is where we begin to put together a plan of action, and this is where intent becomes to manifest itself. We started off by developing some value statements to guide collective action. The Legacy Group was key in helping to develop this. Our overarching vision is that by the year 2019, UTMB will be the gold standard in evidence-based strategic diversity management in academic healthcare. I forgot to wear my glasses. And our mission, the mission for the Diversity Council, is to work together to harness the broad spectrum of ideas, experiences, and voices that characterize the UTMB community. Our values are inclusion, excellence, learning, and collaboration. And all of you have a small card in your pocket folders. And that kind of defines what those value statements are. And I'd encourage all of you to keep them in your badge holder. It's kind of a reminder for why it is that we exist.
Will we be able to get email copies of those of us that didn't attend?
Yes, sir. Most definitely.
Okay,
I'll make sure you get those. Thank you. All right, so all of that led to the formulation of a straw model of a diversity strategic plan, which you all have a copy of in your booklets. Now, the strategic plan or the framework that the Diversity Council is going to work within consists of 9 goals. And these 9 goals fall into 4 broad categories or 4 cycles of impact. Okay? Now, if you look at this wheel, this represents, each of the colors actually represents a cycle of impact. So the very innermost layer of the wheel in red, that represents the academic subcommittee. The second layer in teal represents the health system. And then the outermost layer represents business and finance. The very core of the wheel represents diversity infrastructure optimization. And that's really focusing on how do we begin to build diversity and inclusion in the institution that function, how do we get to inform people, engage them, and motivate them around what it is that we're trying to do. So all of you had an opportunity to identify which subcommittee you were interested in working in, and I was able to put that together in your booklets. I don't know what page it's on. But this is going to be the framework. If you look at this wheel, there's different segments within each layer of the wheel. And each one of those segments aligns with a pillar of the institution, which also aligns with a diversity goal. And those are the goals that are outlined here. So the people pillar, it cuts across all of the entities or all of the subcommittees. That overarching goal is to develop and sustain an internal and external pipeline of outstanding students, faculty, administrators, and staff from underrepresented cultural backgrounds. Goal number 2A and 2B pertain to the academic entity or the academic subcommittee. And that focus is going to be on educational curriculum. One of my key objectives is ensuring that we have a standardized curriculum across all the 4 schools that address cultural competency. 2B is really looking at research, health disparities research. 3A, 3B is focusing on the health system. 4A and 4B focuses on business and finance. And then the very last ones, 5A and 5B, are focusing on diversity infrastructure. So those goals, it represents the overarching framework that the council is going to operate under. Any questions? Okay. Implementation. Now we can talk about impact. What has happened over the course of the past year? So collectively, myself and members of the legacy group of the Diversity Council, we have done the following. The 90-day assessment really helped to build the straw framework for the strategic plan. The strategic plan has been affirmed by the executive committee. So even though it is a kinetic document and you all need to own the plan in some way, shape, or form, the framework has already been set and that's what we're going to operate under. We have implemented some recognition events, activities, preparation of institutional diversity statements for the School of Nursing, for the School of Health Professions, as well as the medical school. Partnership and outreach with diversity professional organizations, which I'll talk about a little bit later. Diversity education as part of leadership development offerings at UTMB. And then I've made several in-service presentations as well. Good Faith Talent Pipeline development efforts. We recently just partnered with the National Black MBA organization at their event. We've also partnered with the National Society of Hispanic MBAs, as well as the Texas Medical Center's Veterans Initiative, which again is focusing on building pipelines in job areas where these groups are underutilized. Assessment of the faculty recruitment process, as well as some recommendations for action. We have developed 2 employee resource groups, which I'm extremely excited about. Lila Rashan is chair for the employee resource group that is going to be focusing on disability inclusion for our students, as well as our employees. And Carol Kerr is focusing on an employee resource group, or an institutional resource group that is focusing on Native American employees. Development of a creative toolkit. And this is some outcomes of what that toolkit looks like. As you can see, we have these banner stands. This was developed in conjunction with members of the legacy group of the council. And we used Dr. Callender's statement around charting the best course for the future by harnessing a diversity of views, ideas, and perspectives. And these are the things that we're going to take on our roadshow to various events where we're trying to build pipelines. We've also developed a phase 1 marketing brochure as well that talks about the commitment to diversity
UTMB's commitment. So it talks about, it outlines some of our initiatives and what it is that we're doing. It also includes the statement from Dr. Callender as well to show leadership support. And what I really like about this image is that when we really think about diversity, you know, I showed you that big diversity wheel. And when you see all of those attributes, the intersection of that really is about creating a certain type of thinking. And that thinking is what influences the way that we interact with each other and behave with each other. And that truly is what diversity is. Diversity is really up here. It's in your mindset. And I think that this image does a good job of communicating that. And I think that's about it with respect to milestones. The last one is this, why we're all here today, the reconstitution of the council. And I want to take a moment to recognize the members of the Legacy Group, because they were the ones who really helped to put all of these things together. They played a key role in helping to select the members of the current or the new Diversity Council. They played a key role with respect to finalizing the Diversity Engagement Survey, which all of you will have a preview of at some point. And they've just done a lot of work, especially with respect to the marketing piece. So I'm going to call out some of the names. Not everyone is going to be here, but I'd like to ask for you to stand so that we can just applaud you for some of your efforts. I'm looking at Deborah. All right, so Dr. Ian Barrett, if you don't mind standing. All right, Deborah Stevens. Monique Ferguson, she's not here. Yanni Benson, Yanni, where are you? She's outside, please, thank you. She helped to put all of this together, all your packets, so thank you so much. Taekwon Do, she's not here. Ernestine Cuellar has retired. Matthew Huant is a student. Carol Jansen, she's a member of faculty who's retired. David Ketchens, Leela Lockett Ware, thank you. Dr. Ron McKinley, thank you very much. Mary O'Keefe, she's not here. Kathy, is she here? Oh, yay, thank you. Thank you. Kathy Osenberger, Faith Robin, yay. And Deidre Walters. Natalie Williams-Boyer, not here, and Carol Kerr. Is she here? Thank you so much. All right, so yeah, this is their collective effort, so thank you all. All right, so planned integration, that's where we talk about an imprint, that's where the Diversity Council comes into play. And what is the definition of a Diversity Council? I like this succinct definition. It is a chartered committee that has a specific task aimed at furthering the organization's diversity strategy. I like to think of all of you as the creative source of abrasion, which is a good thing. It's really about keeping your hands on the pulse of what's going on at the institution with respect to diversity and inclusion. I think of all of you as the influencers and the infusers, and you all are the change agents that are going to help to drive this initiative forward. So I'm excited that all of you are involved in this work. These are some of the goals of a diversity council. It helps to send a signal to the institution that diversity is just a part of the way that we're going to do business. So it helps to make it sustainable. When we think about planned integration, it's really about integration, infusion, mm-hmm. and the diversity council being a cross-section or a microcosm of the UTMB community is positioned to be that group that's going to help to sustain this initiative so that diversity isn't just this one-time event. You know, it's something that is sustainable and it is fully integrated into the way that we conduct business. It expands ownership of issues beyond the usual suspects, if you will. It also promotes credibility for the diversity effort. One of the cornerstones for an effective strategy is to make sure that we're using a familiar infrastructure. And so this is pretty much the governance structure for the Diversity Council. As you can see, these are your four colors, your four teams, your four subcommittees, which also match the entities or mirror the entities of the institution. And what we would like is for each one of the EVPs over academic, health, and business to have oversight responsibility for each one of the subcommittees. So their charge is really to hold us accountable, to help to mobilize resources if needed, to help reward what we're doing, and to really approve some of the things that we're going to propose to do. So this would be the infrastructure that we're using. The last piece in that five-step methodology is really about evaluation. We're currently working on our diversity engagement survey, which should be implemented in the latter part of October. We should do a repeat assessment, maybe after 3-5 years, to see whether there has been some sort of measurable change. As all of you know, we work in an academic environment, so the approach has to be evidence-based. And I think that using some sort of instrument, survey instrument, quantitative instrument will help us to do that. Process-based evaluations is really looking at the effectiveness of the council. Are people actually showing up for meetings? You know, and are we influencing decisions at the institution? Are we influencing policy making? Goal-based evaluation is pretty much basic. We have our goals, you know, have we met them, have we not met them? And then continuous feedback through the balanced scorecard, which all of you have a copy of. All right, I hope I'm doing well on time. Characteristics of council, very briefly. This gives you an idea of who is in the room. An effective council really has to represent a Z-cut touching multiple layers of the institution. And so these are all the business units that are represented here in this room among the 89 members that we have. A lot of individuals from the School of Medicine, which makes sense since they are the biggest school on campus. We have 78 employees, I believe, 9 students, and we also have 2 members of the community. I don't know if they're here today, but if you are, please show your hands. Okay, I guess they're not here. But we have 2 people who are external to the institution. We also have very good representation around race, ethnicity, as all of you can see in the room, as well as generational diversity. It's very present. What exactly is a council? I like to think of the council as just as the group that's going to make sure that we are supporting UTMB by including all interests and all groups in the process of making decisions. The Diversity Council is definitely not a complaint body or a feel-good type of committee that just gets together to feel good, kumbaya. That's not really what it is. But it's really a working body, and I really want the institution to take it seriously. And so it's really about how do we, again, begin to make diversity more strategic and focused. Some of the responsibilities, all of you have this in your handouts. So attendance and meetings, we talked about that in the terms and conditions of the agreement. If you have any questions, let me know. These are some of the responsibilities of the committee chairs, subcommittee chairs. So one of the next steps is we need to begin to crystallize the subcommittees. And as part of that process, we're going to need to identify a chair for that subcommittee and a co-chair. So if you're interested in volunteering, I'm kind of planting the seed right now. But we would need to do that as we move forward. And then myself, Dr. Raymer, would work in a mentorship role with those co-chairs to support them with the initiatives. These are the roles and responsibilities for myself, Dr. Raymer. And then ground rules. All of you have these in your handouts. The key thing for me is have fun. I think that's really, really important. And I think also the confidentiality of this group and the things that go on in the room is also very important as well. It's a sterile environment, as I was communicating to someone earlier. And so we wouldn't just want to invite people randomly to the meeting. Next steps, and I will hand it over to Dr. Gibb. So I broke down the next steps into 5 phases. The first phase is really going to be focused on education and team building. So I want everyone to have a clear understanding or rationale for why they're here. I want to develop a shared meaning around what diversity and inclusion mean. And I think that all of you need that education and development as members of the council. So the first set of meetings will really focus on the educational piece as well as team building. How do effective diversity councils operate? The second phase would be focusing on subcommittee formation. I've already taken a stab at it, but we need to kind of crystallize that and make sure that we're identifying leaders for each one of those subcommittees. The third phase is the most important one, and that's really where we begin to set the agenda. So I shared with you the framework that we're using. I'd like the subcommittees to look at all of those strategies, look at all of those initiatives, and identify what they think are the top 3 priority actions that we need to take to move
to our vision of what it is that we want to be in 2019. So as a group, you would have to do that, and then we would present that to the executive VPs, who would make a final decision as to what it is that we want to do as we move forward. That's performance liftoff. Alignment and implementing is really just about embedding, integrating what it is that we're trying to do into the culture at UTMB, and the sustaining is really just a focus on continuous improvement through some of the evaluation techniques that I described. Okay, any questions? You all are very quiet. Okay. Well, we'll have an opportunity for questions at the end of the meeting. We're now at what I'm really, really excited about, which is our keynote presentation. Diversity ain't nothing but a conversation. I'm going to introduce to all of you Dr. Harry Gibbs. I had the privilege and honor of working for Dr. Gibbs at MD Anderson Cancer Center for almost 7 years. He truly, to me, exemplifies what a leader is. He invested a lot in my own personal and professional development. I consider him a mentor, I consider him a friend, and I'm very thankful that you have dedicated your time and energy to be here today. So I'd like to introduce you to Dr. Gibbs.
First of all, let me tell you, this is really a great honor for me to be here for two reasons. First of all, I've had a lot of bosses in my life, and most of them I would never invite later on to come to an event that I was presiding over. So I really thank Eddie Ola for asking me to come. The other reason, you all saw earlier that Dr. Callender is a true advocate for diversity and inclusion. What you may not know is 13 years ago, as a member of the leadership of MD Anderson, he was one of the more vocal supporters for starting the effort there. So for that, David, I thank you. And I guess our parallel is we both moved from clinical medicine to the dark side of administration. Diversity is a very deep and complex subject, despite what various TV networks would have you believe. And I'm going to give you an example. If you look at my birth certificate, I won't tell you from what year, under race, you will see the word Negro. Now, for those of you over 40, you already have mental images of what that means. If you're under 30, you're pulling out your iPhone going, what did he say? But just that word has a lot associated with it. However, if you look at who I am, my father was half Native American, half African American. My mother was German. My wife is Irish. I have a Mexican daughter-in-law. I have a Nigerian grandson. At my age and my race, I'm supposed to like jazz, and I do, but I also like medieval and Renaissance choral music. Most of my life as a physician, I tried to help people. In another life that I had, I used to teach hand-to-hand combat to SWAT teams in Ohio. I have a sailboat, but I also ride a Harley, and I'm 6'7" and cannot play basketball worth a damn. So, when you talk about diversity, it is a much deeper thing than just talking about, as Addie said, just race and gender. What I want to do today is I want to go through a workshop that we give at our institution. I'm going to try and condense a half-day workshop into 40 minutes. We'll see if I can do it. This is a learning experience that our faculty leaders go through, our administrative leaders go through. In bits and pieces, the Diversity Council has gone through it over the last 11 to 12 years. And it's going to show you kind of how we work with diversity at our institution, what we have found to be successful. One of the things that we struggle with is this attitude of nature versus nurture. Jesse Prinz just put out a book about 3 weeks ago called Beyond Human Nature. And he talks about when we behave, you know, are we born to behave a certain way, or do we learn to behave a certain way? And it's obviously a little bit of both. For example, unless you have a genetic predisposition to be colorblind, when you're born, you know how to distinguish colors. You may not have names for them, but when you're born, you will see things that are red, you will see things that are green. However, you're not born to play baseball. Okay, you may be born with certain genetic traits of hand-eye coordination and speed, but you don't come out of the cradle throwing a fastball, okay, and batting 365. It's something you have to learn. And when we talk about how people behave, how we have our biases and our prejudices, we have to understand it's a mixture of the two. So let me give you neurobiology in a nutshell. What are human beings good at? Here's what we do as human beings. We take the input from our senses, okay, and we create patterns. We don't have claws, we don't have scales, we don't have sharp teeth. Okay, the way we have survived as a species is we've learned how to predict the future. We see things, we hear things, we smell things, we taste things, we feel things, and we create a story in our heads about what that means, and we use that story to guide us in the future. Okay, we're actually not genetically wired to do math. Okay, doesn't mean you can't do math, but as a species, it was important to know that there were snakes in the pit. It was not important to know whether there were 12 or 17 snakes in the pit. We are wired for pattern recognition. That's a good thing, and it's not a good thing at the same time. What it does mean is the world is not the way it is. Okay, the world is the way that you are. Everybody in this room takes that sensory input in, essentially the same sensory input, but the stories that we create are different for each and every one of us. And when we take these stories and put together guidelines for how we're going to act the next time, they're different for all of us. We all have our individual guidelines about what we're going to do. And some of this is cultural. There are two Dutchmen that put together a book called Riding the Waves of Culture in the late 90s. And what they did was they went to 50 companies in 30 countries and surveyed 30,000 individuals all over the world and asked them a whole bunch of questions. This is one of the questions that they asked. Okay, you're riding in a car with a friend and you're going down the street and your friend knocks over a pedestrian. Okay. No witnesses other than you, the friend, and the pedestrian's not talking. At the time that your friend hit the pedestrian, you noticed the car was going 40 miles an hour. You also noticed the speed limit was 20. A few days later, your friend's attorney calls up and says, listen, you know, we're going to trial tomorrow. We're not going to dispute the fact that Fred hit the pedestrian. We all know that. But, you know, if he was going the speed limit, it might go a little bit easier on him than if the judge found out he was speeding. So, you know, he's your buddy. How about doing something for him? How about just saying to the judge he was going the speed limit? In other words, would you lie to help your friend? And based on this survey, interestingly, the answer was it depended on where you came from. Okay? Switzerland, United States, the answer was hell no. I'm not lying for my friend. I'm going to tell the truth. However, if you came from South Korea, Venezuela, more people than not said, yes, I would do it. And it's because in certain cultures, loyalty to your friends and your family is much more important than loyalty to the system, especially if the system hasn't been particularly good to you. So even such things as what we would call common sense, you know, tell the truth, not necessarily in all cultures. And when you start putting people together, you have all of these different views. So the first thing that we do when we start talking about diversity is we start telling people, you need to understand your own view. You need to know where you come from so that you can begin to understand, am I looking at the truth or am I just looking at my view based on my input? And I'm going to claim there are four major components of the way you view the world. Okay, we create our own world through language, we have moods, we have emotions, we have body language or somatics, and then we have our historical discourse. And I'm going to try to go through these very, very quickly. Let's first of all talk about language. Up until the 1960s, if you asked people what was the purpose of language, we would say it's to describe stuff. That's why we have language. That's a chair, that's a wall, that's a camera. In the early 1960s, a gentleman named J.L. Austin, who was a linguist from Oxford, came to the United States, gave a series of lectures at Harvard, in which he said, no, when you're dealing with other people, language does more than just describes things. Language can cause things to happen, and they can create new reality. And his premise was that if I interact with you in language, I can do one of these six things. I can make a declaration. I can make an assessment, an assertion. I can request something from you. I can promise to do something for you, or I can offer to do something for you before you even ask. I'm not going to go through all of these in depth, but a declaration is something like, oh, crap. Okay? Hopefully I didn't describe anything. I'm not asking you to do anything. I'm just declaring something, and you get to make up what that means when I said that. An assertion is the closest thing that we have to a fact in language. If I counted up everybody in this room and said there are 83 people in this room, you could prove me right or wrong by counting the people in the room. Okay? I say it's the closest thing to a fact because, you know, if you're from some culture where you believe your ancestors walk with you, you're going to go, no, there are 733 people in this room. Only I can see them. But in general, okay, an assertion is something you can prove, right or wrong, as opposed to an assessment. Okay, an assessment is my opinion. If I said this room is hot, okay, well, compared to what? Okay, I might be hot, you might be cold, you might be perfectly fine. It is an opinion. It's not a fact. I can have evidence to back up my opinion, but it's not a fact because you really can't prove it right or wrong. And one of the problems we have in diversity, one of the problems we have in culture, is we screw these two things up. Perfect example, Hurricane Katrina. We had two news articles come out. First one, Associated Press, showed a picture of a gentleman, dark skin, through chest-deep water carrying something. And it says, a young man walks through chest-deep floodwater after looting a grocery store in New Orleans. AFP, which is the largest English-speaking news service in Europe, it's based in France, showed two light-skinned individuals in chest-deep water carrying stuff. And it says, two residents wade through chest-deep water after finding bread and soda from a grocery store in New Orleans. I don't know about you. I've never found anything in a grocery store that they've let me walk out with. But you have essentially the same sensory input. People walking through water, only difference is skin color, and the story that one reporter made up was looting, the story the other reporter made up was finding. Okay? What's the truth? Okay, the truth is people are in water carrying something, but we create our own assessments. And that's not bad. Okay, we do this all of the time. Right now, we are all assessing that the architects were good enough that this building is not going to collapse on us. Okay, while we're sitting here. We didn't check blueprints. We didn't go to the construction company. We make assessments all the time. The problem is they're not facts. And they're shaped by your worldview. So if you declare that Mary is lazy, okay, because she didn't show up on time 2 days last week, okay, that lives with Mary perhaps for the rest of her career. Is it the truth? Well, not unless you know why she didn't show up on time for 2 days. So one of the things that we harp on is make sure that you understand when it's your assessment versus when it's the truth. One of the big problems is we think we're good at communicating. And I like George Bernard Shaw, who says the single biggest problem in communication is the illusion that it has taken place. This is largely based on a gentleman named Claude Shannon. Claude was a cryptologist in World War II. After the war was over, he worked for Bell Telephone. And for those of you under 40, there used to be one phone company, okay, Bell Telephone. And his job was to figure out how to reduce interference on telephone lines. The more interference, the more energy you needed to transmit the signal, the more it cost. Well, he found out that we really didn't know how information was transferred. And in 1946, he wrote an article called The Transfer of Information. And this was Shannon's model, okay? You have a sender. The sender has something that needs to be sent. It gets sent, and the receiver gets it, okay? Revolutionary 1946, all right? This is how we think people communicate, okay? I have something to say. I pass it to you, and you receive it. The problem is this is how we really communicate. We say what we say, and other people make up stories about it. I think of something I want to say to you guys. I pass it through 150 filters in my head, okay, my IQ, my native language, where am I, who am I talking to, how do I feel today, do I really want to be here, have I done this talk 150 times already and I don't want to do it again, okay? Something comes across the air, if you have reasonable hearing and English is your preferred or at least a language you understand, you put it through 150 filters in your head and hopefully what you come up with is close enough to what I came up with. Okay? And any of you who have teenage kids understands this. Okay? It is simply not information transfer. It's an interpretation of a lot of different things. So the question is, I just said everybody has their own worldview. Everybody makes their own assessments. Everybody has their own lenses. Everybody has their own filters. How do you communicate? How do you get people in an organization to work together towards a common goal when we all see the world totally differently? So I'm going to do one quick exercise in our workshop. We do a lot. We're only going to do one today. What I would like everybody to do very quickly is just pair up with somebody. You do not have to marry them. We just want to pair up with someone, okay? And once you've paired, and for the folks that are alone in the remote locations, you get to just be observers. Once you've done that, one person just declare themselves person A and the other one will be person B. And here's what I want you to do, okay? When I say go, I want person A to ask person B to do something, a simple request. You can make it something very simple. You can say things like, pretend you're my girlfriend. I really don't care what you do, but make a request. Now, person B, do absolutely nothing but listen. Just listen very carefully. Okay, clear? Okay, ready, go. Okay. Here's what I would like to ask. The people that were listening, people B, raise your hand if you think you heard a reasonable request that if you were so inclined, you could go ahead and fulfill to the other person's satisfaction. So raise your hand. And it's most of you, and some are laughing. I don't even want to know what those requests are. There was a lot of work done in the 80s on artificial intelligence, and part of that work was to determine how people communicate. And the folks that did it came up with components of a reasonable request. Okay? Now, if you think about it, a promise is just the reverse of a request. Okay, so the components are identical. First thing was that you needed a committed speaker and a committed listener. Okay, a number of years ago, I'm watching the football game. My 16-year-old son comes in and says, Dad, can I borrow the keys to the car? Okay, now at that point, he is 100% committed to that conversation. Right? I'm watching the game. So I go, no. To which he says, why not? Okay. He's still 100%, now I'm about 10%. Okay, so I say something like, well, it's too late out. To which he says, yeah, but last week it was later and you let me borrow the car then, why can't I borrow it now? And then we go down this dance, okay, that eventually goes to the place no parent ever wants to go to, and that is when you say, because I'm your father, and you can't have the car, okay? I was not committed to that conversation, but he was. Okay? You have to be committed to it. So if you're in your office, and you have your earbuds in, and the computer screen is on, and your phone is ringing, and you're typing on your iPad, and someone sticks their head in and says, hey, got a moment? Okay, if you're not committed to that, regardless of what culture you come from, it's not going to work out really well. So both people have to be committed to the conversation. Second thing is something that I call a background of obviousness. My program manager, Pat Mayers, is sitting here at the table, and if I suddenly stopped and said, oh man, Pat, I forgot my flash drive for this talk, could you call Carlos and have her send it over electronically? And Pat says, yes. Okay, that's what we said. There's a lot you never heard. OK? Okay. For example, who the hell is Pat? Okay. Do I have the authority to ask her this? Does she know who Carlos is? Does Carlos, whoever Carlos is, know how to send something electronically? That's what we call the background of obviousness. And the more we work with people from other cultures, the more that background is totally different. Okay? We have to remember that. Okay? To me, this is kind of similar to a marriage license. Okay? When you get married, it apparently comes with the ability to read minds. Okay? Because sooner or later, your loved one is going to say something like, if you loved me, you would have known. Okay? Well, no, we don't. So in a multicultural organization, you need to be very, very sure that that background is spoken about and that is shared with people, or else you're not going to get the results that you want. Third thing is condition of satisfaction. We screw this up all the time. Okay. Would you pass me a pencil? Sure. Okay. Wood or mechanical? Eraser on top or no eraser? Number two lead or number three lead? Okay. We don't get that specific. We say things like, can you have that report by next Thursday? Sure. But that person may have no idea what that report is supposed to look like, paper, electronic. We are not very, very good at conditions of satisfaction. And when we promise to do something, we're not very good at finding out what they are, because I know every one of you in this room at some point in your life agreed to do something for somebody and then walked out of the room and went, what the heck did they want me to do? Okay. And then you do things like you ask your friend, you know, or Dr. Phil or somebody to figure out what it is. You need to understand the condition of satisfaction. What exactly do I want you to do so that you will fulfill my request? And then the last thing we never do is a time limit. Okay, let's do lunch. I have no idea what that means. You know, when are we going to do it? MD Anderson has a wonderful mission statement. You know, we're going to eliminate cancer in Texas, the United States, and the world. It's interesting that it's in that order, but I understand. But what's interesting about its mission statement, it doesn't say when. Tomorrow, next year, the Aztec calendar. I mean, if you're going to make a good agreement, you have to have a time limit. Okay? You just have to know when is that going to happen. So knowing that a good request has all of these components, again, person B raised their hand if they thought they heard a good request. And usually it drops by that much. This is really diversity. I didn't use the word race, I didn't use the word gender, I didn't use the word orientation. It's just good communication from one human being to another, regardless of where you come from. If we all just did that, okay, the workplace would be much more fair. Now, if somebody asks you to do something, you have four options, okay? You can say yes, you can say no, you can do what most of us do, which is renegotiate, okay? Nah, I can't do that, but I'll do this. Or in the workplace, you can do something that we call commit to commit later, which usually means I can't give you an answer now. I've got to check with somebody. I'll get back to you on Thursday. And if they never get back to you, then it's really this right here, okay? I was doing some work with the Colorado National Guard, about 200 or 300 active duty military men and women. And we went through this exercise, and I usually ask them, so what are the ways you can respond to a request? And interestingly, out of 200 to 300 people, not a single one came up with saying no. Okay, so in the military culture, okay, apparently that's not allowed. But one of the things I do want to say, and this really isn't really diversity related, but it's just related in general, as leaders, as members of a community, if you do not create an environment where people can say no, you cannot trust them when they say yes, okay? Doesn't mean that they can get away with not doing it, okay? But if you allow somebody to say, I don't think I can do that, it opens up other conversations that talk about, well, what can we do so it can be done? Is it a question of time, resources, money, education? But if you don't allow people to say, no, I can't do that, and I've been in organizations where it is frowned upon to say no, just remember when they say yes, you have no idea what you're going to get. We do spend time on moods and emotions, and I'll give you another neurobiology lesson very, very quickly. One of the things we discovered in the early 1900s is something called neuroplasticity. And what neuroplasticity means is that if certain neurons in your cerebral cortex are always firing at the same time, over time they actually get wired together, biologically and chemically. And you begin to form associations that stick with you the rest of your life. For example, if your whole life you associate lemon, the word lemon, with sour, you will notice that much like Pavlov's dog, when you see a cut lemon on a table, you will start to do that, okay? It's wired into you. Okay? But there are other associations that over time get wired into people, such as if you always assume that every Muslim you meet is a terrorist, that every woman you meet is weaker than a man, or that someone who is homosexual is going to hell, that association is going to be wired into you forever, okay? Good, bad, or indifferent. And the one thing that we do know is you can't get rid of them, okay? Other than trauma and some drugs that I tried in the 60s, these associations are with you for the rest of your life. You can overwrite them, okay? But they're always there. And it becomes important because of how our brains operate. I said we take in various senses, okay? Into the brain, we take it into an area called the limbic system, which when I went through medical school was called the midbrain, but it is the seat of emotion, okay? And in that limbic system, a decision is made. If the sensory input creates a pattern that we believe is a threat to our existence, okay, we send signals to the body to start responding. Okay? If the pattern says, no, we can think about it, we send it up to the neocortex. Okay, so a decision is made in the limbic system, threat, no threat. What is interesting is that this is very, very fast. Okay, this is very, very slow. In fact, it takes about half a second for you to consciously recognize sensory input from your various senses. But if it's viewed as a threat, your body starts reacting long before your conscious brain starts saying, oh, there's something here I need to react to. And the problem with that is there are certain things that are triggered by that limbic system. If we look at ourself, whatever our self is, the me, the I, the ego, we have a certain set of core beliefs that we believe about ourselves. We're good, we're bad, we're tall, we're shy, we're ugly, whatever. And because of these patterns, there are certain emotions that are associated with those core beliefs. And we have designed some core behaviors around those emotions. Now, the unfortunate thing is when you go to the self-help section of Barnes & Noble, you will find hundreds and hundreds of books that deal with this. Learn behaviors, you know, how to be a better person, how to be a better lover, how to make your significant other stop cheating, you know, all this sort of thing. And that's great. But here's the problem. Let's say you're going for the job interview of your life, okay? This is gonna bring you more money than Powerball, all right? You've taken all the courses, you practiced behavioral interviews, you went out and you spent $700, which is your entire retirement account, on clothing. You show up for that interview. You walk into the office of the person who's gonna give you the job of your life. You are confident, and that person says, hey, you have a split in your pants. Did you know that? Okay. In that moment, all of this goes out the window. Okay. Why? Because that comment hits you right here. Hits you with your core belief. That triggers your core emotions, and you go to your core behaviors, not the behaviors you just spent 6 months learning. Okay? Now, can you change this? Well, not really, unless you're aware of what these things are. Moods and emotions are predispositions to actions. These are the responses that the limbic system is giving you to start the body moving long before you've figured out you're moving in that direction. So whatever mood you're in, That's going to determine what you do. It does determine possibilities for action. I have a fellow that Eddie Owen knows very well, Daryl Simmons. Daryl worked for me for a number of years. When Daryl was in college, he was thrown out of a truck, broke his spine. He's been in a wheelchair ever since. He actually has a birthday today. 55? Is that right? When Daryl worked for me, he had one of these tricked out red minivans. You know, the ones that are especially designed for people who cannot use their legs. They have the hand controls. And this was fire engine red, and I saw it every day. On the day that I was supposed to give Daryl his annual evaluation, coming to work, I was cut off by a red minivan. Okay. It was not Daryl, but it looked like Daryl's minivan. And it was not your cut off from traffic. It was, holy mother of God, I almost died here, cut off from traffic. I get to work, I'm in the office, and Daryl comes by in his wheelchair, knocks on the door, and says, "Hey, Dr. G, you ready for my evaluation?" Well, I was smart enough to realize that the mood I was in wasn't going to work out well for Daryl. And so I said, "Now, you know what? How about we do it another time?" Because in that mood, there were certain things I was never going to do. Their options are available to me, but they were not available to me in that particular mood. Difference between moods and emotions. Emotions usually have a cause that you can figure out. You know, my parakeet died. I'm sad today. Whereas a mood is just one of those, gee, I'm sad all the time, and I don't know why. And they are much more insidious because we're not aware of them. We pretty much know when our parakeet dies, we're going to be sad. But we don't always know that we're in a good mood. You know, the people that are mostly in a bad mood seem to be those people that go, "I'm a people person," you know, and everybody on the planet knows they're not. Here's the reason that it's important. Studies have shown that if you feel good at work, you do good work, okay? But they've also shown the most frequent event that sends employees into a bad mood is talking to their supervisor. So those of you that are supervisors understand this. If the workers are happy, they'll do good work. If you're happy, you'll be a good leader. And when you're not happy, realize it and understand there are certain choices you may or may not make at that particular time. We do a lot of work with body language. For the simple reason is this. You can lie with your mouth, but you cannot lie with your body. And human beings are very, very good at picking up body language. A lot of studies, those that do public speaking, have shown that most of the message that we have is based on our body language and not so much on the words that we say. If I stood up here and I said, you know, gee, I'm really happy to be here. I mean, this is like the crowning moment of my career. And I wish I could just stay here all afternoon and talk to you. You guys would know something was up. Okay? And we're very good at doing that. Okay? As infants, human beings are not ready to live on their own, at least until they're 2 years old when they can be mobile. And so we get very good at looking at mom. Okay? If mom looks like she's happy, then we figure things are safe. Okay, if mom looks distressed, we start to worry. And so we're very good at picking up body language. For example, this is just one little tidbit. Your feet point to where you want to go. Okay, so the next time you're at a cocktail party or a meeting and you're talking to someone and they're talking to you, and as they're talking to you, they're talking to you and standing like this and they're talking to you. Okay, there's a tendency for the body to basically show what's really going on. And some of this is cultural, okay? One of the things that we have to know is that body language patterns can be learned. Very good example is in some parts of Southeast Asia, this means I understand. It does not mean I agree with you. And there have been lots of business deals that have gone wrong because person A has said, yep, just talk to her, and she's with it, and that person is just going, yeah, I understand. Doesn't mean I'm going to do it, but I do understand. We've gotten so good at this that there is something called ORE, which is the other race effect. It has been shown that by the age of 6 months, people of a particular race are very, very good at distinguishing facial expressions of people of the same race. So there is some truth to the comment, well, all those people look alike. Because if they're not from the same race, we don't distinguish their faces as well as anybody else. It is a known fact. It's there by the age of 6 months, and there's not a whole lot you can do to get rid of it. If I plunked you in Korea at the age of 4 and you grew up there, you would get better at differentiating between Korean faces, but not as good as a Korean. In fact, the only thing that tends to ameliorate that is if you are multiracial, if you were born and grew up with two races in the household, you're pretty good at doing both races. But we learn this stuff really, really early, and we take it into account when we make our story. Let's talk about history while the tide is coming in. The historical discourse that you have with someone also plays a role in how you view them. We have a lot of males from the Middle East coming in the Anderson to train, and they get here and they discover their department chair is a female. That is a culture shock for them, and they need to learn how to adjust to that. And to use an example, I'm going to use conflict. I know none of you have it, but hypothetically. There's a fellow named Mitch Hammond. He just retired from American University in the DC area. We had him out about 6 or 7 years ago. He's a cool guy. He spent most of his years as a profiler. In fact, he created the profile that caught the Unabomber. He spent some years working with the space station, getting the Russians and the Americans to play nice up in that little tin can. But he's done a lot of work on culture and on conflict. And what he has determined is that if you're having a conflict with someone, you're going to behave in one of four ways. Number one, you're going to be direct with them. We have a problem. We need to deal with it. But you're going to restrain your emotions. And he called that particular thing a discussion style. You can be direct, but you really express how you feel about it. Okay, and that's called an engagement style. You can be indirect. I've got a conflict with you, but we're not going to get to it right away. And you can be emotionally restrained. It's called accommodation. And you can be indirect and emotionally expressive. I fall dead in the center of this. If you have a problem with me, let's discuss it and let's not get excited about it. My wife, being Irish, I think, falls dead over here. Okay? Oh, she's going to be direct. Okay, but she is going to show you how she feels about it. So when my wife and I have a heated discussion, sooner or later, I will say the two words that will drive her up the wall, and those two words are calm down. Okay. Now, we talked about communication. When I say calm down, here's what I'm saying. Look, I know we got a problem. We were doing really well up until this point. In order for us to do really well after this point, we need to get over this. So let's go ahead and have the discussion, and let's not waste a lot of emotional energy in stuff that isn't relevant to the dialogue. Okay? That's what I say. What she hears is, well, let me get this straight. This is important to me, too. In fact, it's so important to me that I have to show you how I feel. I have to show you how much emotional intensity I have in this argument. You're right, we were doing great before this. We're going to do great after this. But in order to get through this, I need to show you how much this means to me to get resolved. At which point, she does the one thing that drives me up the wall. She ratchets up the argument. Okay? Because what she says is, you know, now that I think about it, I don't think you're as invested in this as I am. I don't see any reaction coming from you. Okay? I need to know you're as much invested as I am. What I hear is, oh God, it's going to blow. Now, this has nothing to do with who's right or wrong. She's usually right. What it has to do with how you learned to deal with conflict. And what Mitch found out is this is cultural. Okay. Now, not everybody from every place does this, but in general, if you're from Northern European countries, or you're in what I would call, he called the U.S. white, I would call it the corporate board culture, we tend to be direct and emotionally restrained. We're going to get the problem out on the table. It's agenda number 17. And we're going to deal with it. We're not going to get excited. If you're from the Mediterranean or in the African American culture, there is a tendency to be direct and expressive. Okay? Oh, we're going to talk about it. Okay? But I need to show you how I feel. And in fact, at our institution, we've been having an issue. We have a number of nurse managers who are younger, who have multiple degrees, who tend to be Caucasian, and they are managing nurses who have been there for 30, 40 years, who tend to be African-American and Hispanic, and the managers are complaining that the nurses have an attitude. Okay? Well, they don't have an attitude, okay? They are just as much invested in the problem as everybody else. It's just that they have a different way of expressing it. Japan and many Latin American countries are indirect and emotionally restrained, okay? And it has to do with trust. We're going to talk about the problem, but I don't know you well enough yet. I need to feel more comfortable with you before we bring this issue to the table, so let's not get to it right away. And then folks in the Middle East are kind of the poster children for the dynamic style. Again, not everyone, but there's a tendency to be indirect and expressive. I get most of the calls across these diagonals. Okay, I will get a call from a clinic saying, we have a family from Abu Dhabi down here, and I need your help. It's a diversity issue. And I'll say, well, what's the problem? And they'll say, well, they're pissed off, but they won't tell me why. Okay. It is a cultural issue. And the reason that we point this out is when you're having a conflict with someone, especially someone who sees the world differently than you do, before you pull out that you're an idiot card, realize maybe we're just dealing with different cultural styles, a different way of arguing. In the case of my wife and I now know that when she is getting more and more physically excited, that divorce is not imminent, that it's just her way of showing her involvement. And she now knows that if she wants to know how involved I am, to ask me, because I'm just not going to show it. I'm just not that type of person. So you can deal with the different styles. So I'm going to end up with two quick slides. One is, how do you deal with this mess? How do you run a multicultural organization? Short term, just being aware that we're a multicultural organization, just being aware that we have different worldviews. Focus on that and understand that your view is not the truth with a capital T, okay? It's the truth with a small t, because it's your truth, not everybody's truth. The only two things that have worked long term are immersion strategies. In other words, spend a lot of time with a particular group of people and you find the differences aren't that great. Or an alien invasion, because one of the things we do know is that if there's a greater threat out there, we'll band together against that particular threat. Last slide, really quickly, because Addie asked me to do this. How do we work with cultural competency education at MD Anderson? We're actually in the middle of a major transition. When Addie Ola worked for us, she spent a lot of time developing a number of training sessions in the classroom format, and we almost have a college curriculum with diversity classes. The unfortunate thing is that in these modern times, diversity classes take time, people have to take time out of their schedules to go to them, and it takes up resources. So we are in the process of doing a shift. Most of the didactic stuff, like what do Turkish people eat, that kind of thing, we're now moving to something we call the Cultural Companion, which is a multimedia live streaming format. I wanted to show you a page, but our IT people said it's proprietary and I can't do it. But it's in the final stages of development now, and it's a number of things. It's live chats, it's feeds, it's YouTube videos. It's a way for the MD Anderson community to get this, what I call didactic knowledge. The problem is you can't learn everything by the internet, especially in the area of cultural communication. You actually have to talk to somebody. So we are changing the format of our face-to-face encounters, and we are reducing them to those conversations that are the same no matter where you come from. Doesn't matter what culture you come from, you have to deal with power and privilege. You have to deal with the isms. You certainly have to have patient-provider conversation, and you have to know how to do conflicts. So our classrooms now are focusing on these conversations, and we're actually in the midst now of our training our trainers to do this. And for any of you that are in HR and do training, it's a big shift going from training, which is transferring knowledge and skills, to facilitation, which is to enhance conversation. So actually, I think tomorrow is another session with them. And then I said immersion strategies work. We're in the process of developing a diversity boot camp for the graduates of our Faculty Leadership Academy. We're going to give them an in-depth experience over 6 months of what it's like to live in a multicultural environment. We're going to give them a disability for a day, for example. We're actually going to take them to the Houston Hispanic Chamber of Commerce and let them sit in a meeting where they don't know the language and things like that, just to give them a feel of what it might like to be like if you come from a different culture. So that, in a nutshell, is a four-hour course. You guys are very privileged. You got it in about a third of the time. I want to thank you guys for having me here. I wish you all the luck with the council. You're bigger than our council. I do want to say, if you have any specific questions about our council, how we run it, how we manage it, the good things and the bad things, Pat is now in charge of the council and knows more about it than I do. And I'm sure she'd be happy to answer your questions. So thank you very much.
UTMB, working together to work wonders.